Now we are very excited to have Professor Pacheta Chikmeti. Pacheta is a professor in the William E. Point Department of Aeronautics and Astronautics and adjunct faculty member in the Department of Electrical Engineering at the University of Washington, Seattle. He will give us a talk about optimization-based control of autonomous aerospace systems. Now the floor is yours, Professor.
Thanks for inviting me for this talk. I really appreciate it. And I also enjoyed the talks before me. This is a great meeting. Thank you. Today, I'll talk about an overview of the research going on in my lab. For people who have been to my talks, they will see a lot of commonalities with the previous ones. But hopefully, others will enjoy the overall team and the research going on in the lab at University of Washington. So today I'll talk about autonomous aerospace systems, but most of my applications are motivated with my professional past in space applications particularly. And I had the opportunity to implement some of these ideas that I developed over years in actual missions. One of them was Mars Science Lab, which landed on Mars in 2012, August of 2012. And I developed the flyaway guidance navigation and control algorithms, which made use of an optimization formulation for actuator management part of the controller, and which allowed us actually to do the maneuver it was responsible to do much better than it was anticipated. The main maneuver was that when you contact Mars with the rover, you might have seen the videos of this because it happened again recently. You lower the rover with a winch and then you turn sky crane and then you make it fly away. And the expectation was that this, with the fuel allocation, this sky crane could fly maybe a couple of hundred meters. But with the use of optimization and the problem formulation with optimization, we were able to make it fly 650 meters in 2012, far away from the the rover, which eliminated any danger to the rover. And in 2020, recently in February, this algorithm was reused with very minor modifications, and this time it flew 700 meters very successfully. And then I'll talk about the second piece today, which is the piece that I worked on while I was at NASA Jet Propulsion Labs and later on in academia. It's called GFOLT, Guidance for Fuel Optimal Large Diverts. This was the first real-time optimization-based control utilized on a rocket to divert the rocket from an intended target sideways, which is not the natural flight pattern for a rocket. So this was a unique demonstration, and I'll explain some of the technical background of this technology development. And then, of course, SpaceX started landing their reusable rockets, and it turned out that optimization-based control was an enabling technology, and this is one of the things I really feel happy because I think our developments impacted at least the way that they formulated their problems and tackled their challenges during the landing part of their missions. And then, of course, we applied these ideas to other space missions, like landing on comets and asteroids, where you had to, in real time, design trajectories to safe sites and so on. As I mentioned, there was a news flash, I guess. It has been a couple of months now. Maybe I'm a bit late, but the Mars lander Perseverance landed on Mars. Again, it, as I mentioned, it used an optimization-based control algorithm for thrust allocation, which made a major difference in terms of flight distance it guaranteed. You can see it in both pictures. This was in 2012 where Curiosity landed and where the sky crane eventually crashed, hard landed. And this year, during this landing, here is where Perseverance landed, and this is where the descent stage or the sky crane crashed. This was about a little bit over 700 meters, I believe, the distance. And this is a picture from the Perseverance rover that NASA released of the crash site, the distance. You can see the plume. This was one of the most interesting pictures I have ever seen, even though it doesn't look much, but it's on Mars, so that's what makes it interesting. So today I'll talk about some of the ideas that goes, that are behind this kind of methodologies and some of their applications. First, I want to explain what I will talk about at the high level, which is primarily today trajectory planning. This is a simplified view of how trajectory planning, feedback control, state estimation interact with each other. Here, trajectory planners design trajectories optimal for some mission specifications within some constraints. This green set, if you like, is the constraint set. You generate this nominal red trajectory and with a model of the system that you know, nominal model, let's say. Of course, reality will be different than the model. So you will deviate from this trajectory for many reasons, maybe imperfect sensing, imperfect models, imperfect model parameters, and so on. And disturbances, of course. Your goal is with feedback to keep this trajectory, actual one, which is the black one, as close as possible to the red one that you design, hopefully in some sort of tube that is entirely within the constraint set. That's what you are trying to do, ultimately. And feedback control is mainly dealing with uncertainty and handling it. State estimation is giving you the best knowledge of your system state. This is your plant that you are controlling, and trajectory planners are giving you updates on the nominal paths that you have to follow. And today I'll explain how do we do trajectory planning with optimization, particularly with convex optimization. This is the high level view. When you write this trajectory optimization problems with its their cost metrics and constraints, they typically turn out to be what we call non-convex or hard optimization problems, because typically there are multiple minima, and the sets you are optimizing over are non-convex, meaning that you can always find two points for which the connecting line may go out of the feasible set. These problems tend to be difficult to solve. There are issues with guarantees of convergence to a solution, even when one exists. And typically you cannot ensure global optimality in this kind of problems. And the key idea has been turning these problems which are non-convex to convex optimization problems, which we refer to as convexification. The goal is to convert the cost function to a convex cost and the set over which you are optimizing to a convex set. And a convex set is the one with which has a nice structure. Any two points in the set is, any line between any two points between in the set remains in the set. That's the key property of convexity. And once you have convex optimization problems, you can guarantee reliable, fast solutions. That's the key point. There are algorithms which ensure solutions. And when one exists, when one doesn't exist, it tells you, within the numerical tolerances you specify, that there exists no solution. The key difficulty is, of course, convexification, and afterwards to ensure that you can actually solve them in real time during operations. Those are the key challenges. One is more on the theoretical side, the other is on computational side, and hopefully today I'll explain some of the progress we made over years on both areas. So a control problem or a trajectory planning problem, specifically in this talk, typically has several aspects. One is the nonlinear, nonlinearity in dynamics is a major source of non-convexity you have to deal with. A non-convex state and control constraints, I'll give you some examples, and potentially non-convex costs or rewards. The last one is not a major concern, but it can also have this kind of issues. We can also have this kind of issues in costs and rewards, sources of non-convexity. And then convexification, we have two techniques I'll talk about today. One is what we call lossless convexification. This is a technique we developed over years to convert control constraints, typically that are non-convex. The non-convexity is on the control constraints, not on state constraints. And then we have, if we have sources of non-convexity on state constraints, including nonlinear dynamics, we utilize a form of sequential convex programming, which we refer as successive convexification method. That ensure local optima, of course, we can claim global optima. In the previous case, if we can losslessly convexify, we can ensure global optima. But in the second case, we cannot ensure global optima, but we can still have some assurances which are useful for real-time trajectory planning. Here is a prototype example from aerospace. This is the example that actually I used to be into mostly robust control during my PhD. I used to work on robust control, linear matrix inequalities, synthesizing robust controllers that satisfy certain constraints and such, and then applying it to also nonlinear systems. While I was at JPL, I was given this problem, which was planetary landing problem, Mars landing particularly. And this was the Mars, more specifically, it was Mars pinpoint landing problem. This typical scenario, including the one that recently landed, is as follows. You enter Martian atmosphere after 7-8 months of cruise from Earth. You start slowing down because of the aerodynamic drag that you feel as you enter the atmosphere. And you try to manipulate that drag force by manipulating the orientation of the vehicle in a limited way. But this takes out a lot of the velocity you have, if you like. It slows you down. But Martian atmosphere is not thick enough, dense enough to slow you down. It's 1/100 of Earth's atmosphere in terms of density, you know. So it's really not dense at all. At some point, at supersonic speeds, you open your parachute, which we call supersonic parachute for obvious reasons, because we are still at supersonic speeds. This slows you down even more. But again, atmospheric drag is still not enough to slow you down to acceptable levels. So at some point, you cut this parachute and you turn on your engines, thrusters. This happens around 2-3 kilometers above the ground. That will take out the last piece of velocity you are left with. I mean, just to give you an idea, when you enter the atmosphere, you are at, about 26,000 kilometers per hour. I forgot the exact numbers, but around 20,000 plus minus 20% speeds. And when you turn on the thrusters, you are at 300-400 kilometers per hour speeds. You know, again, you took out a lot of the velocity, but you still have quite a bit left. You are still flying very fast. And till now, including the last mission, we ensure the landing accuracy of about 10 kilometers, 8 to 10 kilometers, I think. What that meant was, if you have an ideal point given to you on Earth, let's say people decided this is the point I want to land, what we could ensure was, okay, we can land within 8 to 10 kilometers neighborhood of this, all right? That's not very accurate. We do some last second maneuvers to avoid obstacles maybe along the in landing site now, thanks to a new technology called terrain relative navigation, but that's just to do minor adjustments at the very end. It's not to correct for the miss that we accumulated during the miss distance that we accumulated during the entry and parachute phases. So to be able to do that, to do what we call pinpoint landing, i.e. landing within certain less than a kilometer, much less than a kilometer neighborhood of a predetermined target, you have to be able to fly back almost 8-9 kilometers from an altitude of, let's say, 3 kilometers, just to give you an idea. And you are going potentially away from the target with 300-400 kilometers per second. So you have to do a quite aggressive maneuver to come back to the target, if you like. That's called pinpoint landing. And the trajectories that the nominal even trajectories generating them online in real time is not easy, because these trajectories tend to be at the borderline of the infeasibility sometimes. They are hard trajectories. So this was the problem. So we had to be able to fully utilize the flight envelope of that rocket, if you like. So what's the problem? In its simplest form, which is quite applicable to Mars actually, you have a lump mass model with a thrust vector attached to a lump mass, you know. And this thrust vector has an upper bound, a lower bound, and it's a pointing constraint. In 2D, it's easy to draw that, which is the blue area here, which turns out to be non-convex. And this was making the problem difficult and non-convex. And there was another source of non-convexity too, but that's relatively minor in comparison. Basically, lossless convexification ensures that this constraint can be handled with a convex lifting and relaxation. But in its original form, the problem was non-convex, and it was due to a non-convexity in the control variable. There was, again, one in the also dynamics due to mass depletion. We handled it with a transform of a variable. But the convexification of the thrust constraints was as follows. You took this feasible region, which is this, in this case, green area, lifted up to a third dimension. In 3D, you lifted up to a fourth dimension by introducing the slack variable. I think this is gamma. Saying that anything in this cone cut by a plane is feasible, even including inside that cut, which is a convex region. But what you realize is that the curved boundary of that convex region can be projected back to the original set feasibly. But then what optimal control theory gives you the ability is to prove mathematically that all the optimal solution of this relaxed problem will have this property that the optimal optimal controls will be at the curved boundary of this new set, if you like, which can be projected feasibly to the original set. So what you accomplish by doing that is you solve the problem on a larger convex set. Hence, you will, of course, get at least equally good solutions to the optimal solutions of the original problem. But what you are proving is all the optimal solutions are actually transferable to optimal feasible solutions of the original problem, hence optimal solutions of the original problem. Anyways, once you prove it mathematically, now you can use numerical tools of convex optimization to solve this problem. I'll talk about how we did it a little bit more as we go, but eventually we also develop numerical solvers, custom numerical solvers to solve these problems extremely fast. At the time on a laptop, our custom solver could solve this problem in less than 10 milliseconds, I think, roughly. On a ruggedized PC, which was very slow, we put the algorithm on a ruggedized, an old PC, on a rocket, and in that case, it solved the problem, I think, in less than 100 milliseconds. So we could solve them in real time for the purposes of rocket trajectory planning. And we flight tested these algorithms first with offline generated trajectories, then online real-time generated trajectories in 2012-13, and then with terrain relative navigation with a camera on board doing state estimation, for state estimation. And I'll show you a video that shows one of our later flights. This was pre SpaceX landing, so this was the state of the art. Then, of course, SpaceX, it's very spectacular landings, but still, I think this was quite motivating for them to see too.
As the Madison engineering team performs the final system checks on Zombie, JPL's new fuel optimal large divert guidance algorithm, known as GFOLP, is about its largest demonstration to date. With support from NASA's Flight Opportunities Program, this groundbreaking project enables JPL to validate robust landing technology. This Google Earth visualization is created from the actual trajectory data recorded by Zombie in flight. The trajectory may look simple, but this flight represented an unprecedented achievement in autonomous rocket technology. The half-mile translation across the desert was in fact a spontaneous landing diversion in which the rocket was commanded to abort its initial nearby landing spot during final approach, aggressively change direction, and begin following a new trajectory that was first calculated only 1 second later. The GFOLP computer calculated this new trajectory mid-air in real time, choosing a new landing site in the distance, and optimizing the path through the sky to burn the least amount of fuel possible. Although the engineering teams knew the intended landing diversion before launch, the vehicle systems received the updated instructions mid-flight with no advance warning. Once commanded to change direction, the system instantly throttled up the engine and aimed the vehicle hard over to meet the new objective. This flight was yet another expansion of Zombie's vehicle flight dynamics, reaching a maximum altitude of 1,200 feet while flying out of plane with the landing pads, then traversing downrange nearly a half mile over the desert floor at more than 50 miles an hour before gently touching down within 9 inches of its target.
In rocket world, this problem is referred to as a broomstick on your finger, like a magician. You have one engine which you can gimbal, like your finger, you can move it around a little bit, you know. And by doing that, you are trying to control 6 degree of freedom motion of the rocket, more or less, except maybe one, because we are taking out the roll with the small roll thrusters, because we don't care about roll along the vertical axis, if you like, z-axis of the vehicle. And you're going to see that also these maneuvers that you're seeing are not very natural maneuvers for this kind of vehicle. Actually, we make it divert to 850 meters sideways with the fuel available. Actually, we could have done more, but this vehicle, they were scared that it may come apart due to aerodynamic forces, due to high speeds. So they put a speed limit and a tilt tip limit on the vehicle. Those are the main factors that limit our ability to fly sideways. I think we could have gone substantially more than this from an altitude of about 400 meters, which is, if you see in real life, it's quite a maneuver, actually. As I said, SpaceX did much more spectacular landings afterwards, even landing two at the same time. I think it was in 2016, if I'm not misremembering. And they also wrote in a journal article written by Blackmore, Lars Blackmore, who is a close collaborator of mine. He has been over years. He talked about how this development, I would recommend reading it, and he acknowledges also our work quite a bit in that article. And then the most important point is the fact that they use convex optimization, not because it's nice to use, because they made it turned out to be enabling. So are there other problems with the same source of non-convexity? Yeah, there is this quad rotor flight problem, where we are designing trajectories for quad rotor, and you can model it in a similar way. There is a thrust vector that lives in a, you know, it has a lower and upper bound. The reason for a lower bound in the rocket case was you don't want to turn on lower the thrust values too much below some threshold, because then thruster may shut down and it may never restart, and the mission is over, of course. Then,
excuse me, Professor.
In this case, the reason is a bit more interesting. When you bring the propeller's speeds below a certain threshold, you may lose attitude control, because you are using the same propellers to do attitude control by doing differential thrusting, if you like. And that's why you want to have to maintain a proper level of attitude control. It's best to operate within some lower and upper bounds, depending on the propeller, of course, you're using. So this is another example. We also managed to convexify other type of control constraints, like when you have mutually exclusive, both non-convex sets, you can do a similar lifting in two stages and show by generalizing the concept of non-singularity of optimal trajectories, you can generalize some of these results quite a bit, much more than I originally anticipated, actually. And we have some recent papers and hopefully some more coming on this. Another example of that is doing rendezvous docking with a rotating spacecraft. It was a nice example. There are details in a video. You can go to our website and see all the details, where here the non-convexity is on-off thrusting. The thrusters are either off. And when they are on, there was a lower and upper bound, and the lower bound wasn't zero. So this is an interesting non-convexity. We handled that. There is another constraint of similar type for landing. if you have a rocket that has different tilt angle constraints depending on its speed, so at high speeds, low tilt angle constraint, the IE the red region, and the high thrust mode. At the low thrust mode, at high thrust mode, you have low tip and tilt. At the low thrust mode, you can rotate the engine more. So that's another interesting source of non-convexity which we could handle in controls. But these are control constraints that can be non-convex. When you have state constraints, the situation is not as clean. For example, you may have nonlinear dynamics and non-convex state constraints, like in this even small Dubinsky example. And for that, we have been using a sequential convex programming approach to solve this problem. That's what. And what happens is, in these cases, you have, as I mentioned earlier, you have a cost. J may have non-convexities. F, the dynamics defined by F, may have nonlinearities, which is a major source of non-convexity. As I mentioned, the non-convexities in control constraints can be handled with maybe previous tricks, but on state variables, the situation is not as clean. And there are maybe mixed state and control constraints, which again, similar situation. To handle this, the idea is that you still want to use methods of convex optimization, like interior point method algorithms, which we have been using for solving this convex optimization problems we set up. The goal is to generate a higher level algorithm via SCP, sequential convex programming, where at each level of iteration, a convex problem is solved by using an interior point method algorithm, for example. That's the basic idea behind SCPs. Here is how we convexify the problem successively to generate this succession of convex problems, which we solve with interior point method algorithms. We start with an initial guess. Later on, we generate our initial guesses by solving the problem repetitively. We should have said convexify the non-convex constraints around this initial guess. And then we use also thrust regions and what we call virtual controls to handle artificial infeasibility in the problem that may be introduced during the succession, and to handle unbounded results, unboundedness with thrust regions. Then we discretize the problem, give it to any, the problem is now convex, it's a parameter optimization problem, not an optimal control problem after discretization. You solve it with interior point method algorithms, update the trajectory, send it back, do that thing over and over again. So there are two layers of iteration, if you like. One is at the trajectory layer, the other is at solving the convex problem that's generated, which is at the lower level, if you like. So you solve each problem iteratively, which is guaranteed to converge. Then you do this higher level trajectory iteration, which we call in our method, which we call successive convexification. An example of it is, for example, the SpaceX flip maneuver. Here is an example where the dynamics is nonlinear. There are some non-convexities in controls, constraints as well. There's aerodynamic drag and so on. So maybe in this version we didn't have it, but in current version we are working, we have the aerodynamic drag and lift. This is a simple enough, but very nice example. Again, broomstick on your finger example, if you like. You can have access to this through GitHub. My student put a code online. It's open source. It's a good enough problem to get acquainted with this type of method. If you are interested, I encourage you to play with it. Hopefully, we will put more code. There is also a Control System Magazine article we are writing. Soon will be published, at least send out. Hopefully, we'll put on archive too, with my colleague in Stanford, Marco Pavon, which will have a bunch of examples that you can test these algorithms on. Again, open source. Let me quickly go to this point. These algorithms at the trajectory level converge very, very fast, typically. Here, for example, in this example, it converged to a desirable level in six iterations or five iterations, trajectory iterations. This is very typical in many examples we run these algorithms on. And there is a mathematical reason behind it. It turns out that this convergence results at the trajectory level are superlinear. That means really fast. And that's what we have been observing also. For sake of time, I'll also talk about, as I mentioned, in successive convexification, at every trajectory iteration, you generate a convex problem and you solve it. You know, so how do we solve it? In the past, we have been solving, even now, with interior point method algorithms, which are second order methods. They generate Hessian type information internally and that they use it. That's why per iteration cost of those algorithms are kind of high, but they converge with fewer iterations. Okay. We have been recently experimenting with first order methods whose per iteration cost is very, very, very low, but they require more iterations. So our goal is to see whether having such a low per iteration cost allow us to solve these problems a bit faster. Right? And we have been developing some algorithm. This is recently documented, the first version in a recent journal, but we will hopefully have another more extended version with some more bells and whistles. The idea is, let's say you are solving a quadratic cost minimization problem with some linear equality constraints, because it's a convex problem, and with some convex constraints. I'll describe some examples to this. This is a relatively generic convex optimization problem. It's not all inclusive anyways, but it's something that we face all the time for trajectory planning at least. And here H is positive semi-definite, Z is closed convex set. Okay. And we are using what we call a proportional integral projected gradient algorithm. It's actually, for controls people, it's such an intuitive algorithm. What it does is, by using the first order gradients, it makes a projection, prediction on what should be your step size for the convex optimization solver. But then it also uses an integrator term to monitor equality constraints, if you like, these linear equality constraints. If you think of a PI control, what it does, the integrator does, is it rejects constant disturbances and it tracks constant references perfectly. If you have any intuition about integrators, that's the least that might have been taught in classes you might have taken. And the same idea exists here. It turns out that you can treat this H here and this G here, H as the disturbance, constant disturbance, G as the constant reference, if you like. And you can generate this projected gradient algorithm, method algorithm, with an integrator augmented to it. Okay. And this turns out, what you do here, that's a difficult process, is this projection. Pi is this projection onto set Z. If you can do this projection quickly, then you have a very quick algorithm. And it turns out that in control problems, trajectory planning problems, these are actually doable things for many examples. And you also have a nice continuous time interpretation of this, of course, discrete time algorithm, where the projection is the nonlinearity in the feedback block, and you have a PI controller here that is controlling a single integrator dynamics, if you like, right? Of course, this is the continuous time interpretation. I generate these things in Simulink and run them to do the optimization. I would recommend this kind of playing around. It's not only fun, it's very educational, I think. Anyways, it turns out that in optimal control, most of the state constraints, inequality constraints, are per time step constraints. And they require projections into simpler sets like balls, ellipsoids, boxes, cones. Second order cones, these are complicated cones, but nevertheless cones, convex cones, half spaces, things like that. And there are analytical ways to project on them, i.e. there are closed form expressions you can use to project. There are no iterations needed. But the trick is to project into their intersection, which is not analytic. For that, we use other techniques. I will not get into that, but we have some techniques. Actually, one technique is to add more integrators. That's another interesting thing. The other is using something like ADMM. Anyways, with that, we can prove nice convergence results too, by using some techniques that are inspired from Nesterov and his work. We use this just for comparison on our landing example, but on some other examples too, rocket landing example, but for example, this GRASP, everybody tends to give this as a good example, and we agree it's a good example, where you are holding a box with four fingers and moving it around and optimizing its trajectory. You have an objective function, bunch of constraints that I summarized here. Another example we compared against is doing successive convexification to traverse around obstacles. And again, there are complicated constraints. And here are some timing results. When we compare with Grobe, one of the fastest solvers commercially available for convex and mixed integer convex programming problems. And with the first order methods, these are just some comparisons. You know, you're now solving these problems extremely fast. That's the bottom line. Our solvers are not in any way optimized in terms of the software qualities of them. They have some still obvious advantages. They require minimal or no memory allocation during execution, and warm starts help them a lot, which can be done per problem that you are dealing with. And we have been testing these algorithms in our flight arena. We have an indoor flight arena. I am really proud of that. It's generated by my student, developed by my student, Michael Mikizumuk. He's now with Amazon Prime Air. He's one of the key control algorithm developers. And hopefully they will deliver goods with quad rotors. Or not quad rotors, multi rotors in that case, not quad. And we are testing our algorithms on our vehicles. Our vehicles have our own autopilot, in-house developed autopilot with our own solvers. Every line of code is written in-house. Our controllers are in-house and so on. We also have an outdoor capability where we fly this, not with motion capture, but with GPS. And we have a user interface which we developed where it's a modeling tool, visual modeling tool of optimal control. For optimal control, you can specify some constraints, especially state constraints on this visual interface, and the software automatically generates the control problem with constraints underneath. You don't even have to see it. You don't have to be an expert user. And we also use the same autopilot on other type of vehicles, like ground robots and so on, which we have. And I'll show you some maneuvers in the last couple of minutes I have. This is a nice example where we are traversing between 10 obstacles. Of course, obstacle locations are given. We are not doing perception. We are just optimizing the flight. Here is a visual interface where you are seeing that we are flying artificially quad rotor over between obstacles, and each as we move, the real-time trajectory optimization is happening. That's to show that it's happening in real time with the visual interface. We can show that. And these are some easy flights. Here are some not so easy flights. And another thing I would point to is the stability of our flights and also maneuvers. And this is because we also pay a lot of attention to feedback control design. Our feedback controllers are another story, but they are very well designed by using techniques of robust control and so on, which is not discussed much these days, but I think it's equally important. If you don't have good controllers, all the rest is not that as meaningful. I'll show you one more maneuver, hopefully that will be the end of my presentation, which is a maneuver where we are flying through moving obstacles. Here what you will see is there will be three quad rotors that will form a triangle. They will fly back and forth, and the other fourth quad rotor will fly through them. First, it will know the flight pattern, but in the middle of its flight, as it's going through, it will be given another information, an unanticipated change in their motion of the obstacles, if you like, and it will adjust in real time to that change by generating a new trajectory. In mid-flight, it got the update that the obstacles changed their mind and they started flying backwards. So it adjusted its trajectory accordingly. These are all on our website. If you go, we have a YouTube channel too. If you go there, please sign up so I can claim we have, people are visiting us. this is my group recently, a couple of years back. After COVID, we didn't see each other much. This is the group before that, like maybe five years ago. So people are getting older. These are people who helped me during this process. Many people contributed. Some are not here on this list, maybe. And these are our sponsors. I'm thankful to them for their financial and technical support. And thank you for listening to me, and thanks for inviting me.
Thank you, Professor Pichet. It was a very interesting talk.